नमस्ते। सहस्राक्षं गुणादीशं स्वगुरुं च सरस्वतीं जनकं जनयित्रीं च सहस्रादो प्रणमाम्यहम्। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, मैसेल्फ डॉक्टर नारायण केयर। टुडे विल बी डिस्कसिंग वन मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ शल्य तंत्र, दैट इज त्रिविध कर्म। सो एज अ नेम इटसेल्फ सेज, विल डायरेक्टली गो टू द टॉपिक। एज अ नेम इटसेल्फ सेज, त्रिविध कर्म, देर आर थ्री कर्मास विच हैव बीन एक्सप्लेन इन दिस टॉपिक, त्रिविध कर्म। इफ यू सी ऑलमोस्ट ऑल द क्लासिकल संहितास, ऑल द चिकित्सा कर्मास हैव बीन एक्सप्लेन्ड और कैटेगराइज अंडर दीज हेडिंग्स। मे नॉट बी मेंशन डायरेक्टली, इवन देन इट हैज बीन क्लासिफाइड और एक्सप्लेन्ड इन दीज थ्री कैटेगरीज, दैट इज द त्रिविध कर्मास। सो वॉट आर दोज त्रिविध कर्मास? सो एज पर आचार्य सुश्रुत इन अग्रोपहरणीय अध्याय ही सेज त्रिविधम कर्म, पूर्वकर्म, प्रधान कर्म, पश्चात कर्म इति। सो दैट इज इन द फिफ्थ चैप्टर थर्ड श्लोक ही सेज देर आर थ्री विध कर्मास, दैट इज त्रिविध कर्मास, दे आर पूर्वकर्म, प्रधान कर्म, पश्चात कर्म। सो वॉट आर दीज? विल बी स्टडींग दीज इन डिटेल इन टूडेज क्लास एंड विल स्टार्ट ऑफ। सो दीज त्रिविध कर्मास, अगेन ही हैज नॉट एक्सप्लेन्ड इन डिटेल, सो ही हैज जस्ट मेंशनड देर आर थ्री कर्मास, पूर्व, प्रधान एंड पश्चात कर्म। Whereas Acharya Dalhana, while commenting on the same shloka, he explains each and every karma in detail in different contexts that we will be seeing today. So coming to the commentary of Acharya Dalhana, so in the same shloka, that is 5.3, so he says the whole concept of Trivida karma can be explained under three contexts. So what are these contexts? The first one being the context of with the progression of the disease or the stages of the disease, this Trivida Karma can be categorized, and he has explained that in the following shloka. So he says, Chayadinam Purva Rupantanam Atankotpattehe Pragyat Iti Purva Karma. That is, Chayadinam Purva Rupantanam, from the Chayavastha of the Kriyakalas till the Purva Rupanta, Purva Rupavastha, that is, from the point of Chaya till the Purva Rupas originate, that is in the Avastha of Sthana Samshraya, whatever the karmas that has been done is considered to be Purva Karma. He continues that and saying, Atanka Utpatteha Pragyat, that is, Atanka Utpatteha Pragyat, that is, before the development of the Atanka, that is a Vyadi, all those procedures which are done can be categorized under Purva Karma. So one criteria is, so from the point of Chaya till the Purva Rupa, development of Purva Rupa, what are the karmas done, they are considered as Purva Rupas, and before the Utpatti of the Vyadi or the Atanka, those procedures which are done are considered under Purva Rupa. So this is clear. So we will continue. He again explains Pradhana Karma as Atankotpattav Yat Tat Pradhana Karma. So once after the development of the Vyadi or the Atanka, those karmas which are done, they are considered under Pradhana Karma. And he explains Paschat Karma as Nivritta Atankasya Anubandha Upacharanat. Nivritta Atankasya Anubandha Upacharanat Yat Tat Paschat Karma. That is, once after the Atanka is Nivritta, that is, it has been cured, after that Anubandha Upacharanat, if there are any Anubandha Vyadis or Anubandha Lakshanas which are left out, or after the cure of, complete cure of the Pradhana Vyadi, and if there are any minor symptoms left out, all those karmas which are done to cure these anubandha lakshanas, they are considered under paschat karma. So this is as per the criteria of progression of the disease or stages of the disease pathogenesis. This is explained by Acharya Dalhana. He again gives one more context and he says langanadi virekantam purva karma vranasyacha. So that is in the treatment of vrana, in the context of Shalya Tantra, so Langhanadi Virekantam, from the chikitsa of Langana up till the Virechana, that is, if you consider Langana, that is Apatarpana, Alepa, Parisheka, Abhyanga, Snehana, Svedana, Vimlapana, Upanaha, Pachana, Visravana, Snehana, Vamana and Virechana. So Langana till Virechana, all those procedures which comes can be considered under Purva Karma for the treatment of Vrana. So this is mainly explained for Shalya Tantris and for the Chikitsa of Vrana in Shalya Chikitsa aspect. एंड ही सेज पाटनम रोपणम यत च प्रधान कर्म तत्स्मृतम. पाटना एंड रोपणा द प्रोसीजर विच स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम द पाटना एंड विच एंड्स इन रोपणा ऑल दोज प्रोसीजर्स विच कम इन बिटवीन कैन बी कंसिडर्ड अंडर प्रधान कर्म इन केस ऑफ व्रण चिकित्सा. एंड ही फर्दर कंटिन्यूस बलवर्णाग्नि कार्या तु पश्चात कर्म समाधिशेत. बलवर्ण अग्नि कार्य सो वंस आफ्टर द क्यूर ऑफ द व्रण सो लेटर यू हैव टू गो फॉर बलवर्णाग्नि कर्म दैट इज फॉर नॉर्मल गेटिंग बैक द नॉर्मल वर्ण फॉर गेटिंग बैक द नॉर्मल बला एंड अग्नि ऑफ द पेशेंट. वट आर द प्रोसीजर्स दैट विल बी डूइंग दोज थिंग्स कैन बी कंसिडर्ड एज पश्चात कर्म इन केस ऑफ व्रण चिकित्सा. सो दिस एक्सप्लेनेशन दिस थ्री एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ पूर्व प्रधान एंड पश्चात आर एक्सप्लेन्ड एज पर व्रण चिकित्सा और शल्य चिकित्सा. अगेन दिस इज एज पर दधानाचार्य. सो अगेन फर्दर ही गिव्स वन मोर कॉन्टेक्स्ट एंड सेस अन्ये तु संशोध्यस्य. सो इन अदर संशोधन चिकित्सास और इन अदर वर्ड्स पंचकर्म चिकित्सास. सो व्हाट आर द पूर्व प्रधान पश्चात कर्म ही सेस पाचन स्नेहन स्वेदनादि पूर्व कर्म दैट इज आमपाचन स्नेहन एंड स्वेदन कैन बी कंसिडर्ड एज पूर्व कर्म इन केस ऑफ संशोधन कर्मास. दीस आर पूर्व कर्मास विथ रेस्पेक्ट टू द पंचकर्मास. अगेन ही कंटिन्यूस वमन विरेचन बस्तिनस्य शिरामोक्षणानि प्रधान कर्मं तु यत् दैट इज द फाइव पंचकर्मास कैन बी कंसिडर्ड एज प्रधान कर्म इन केस ऑफ संशोधन चिकित्सा. एंड अगेन पेयाद्यन्न संसर्जनम पश्चात कर्म इति दैट इज पेयादि कर्म पेयादि अन्न पेया अन्न विलेपी एक्सेट्रा द संसर्जन कर्म कैन बी कंसिडर्ड एज प्रधान कर्म इन केस ऑफ संशोधन कर्म. सो दीज थ्री कॉन्टेक्ट्स हैव बीन एक्सप्लेन्ड बाय आचार्य डल्हना वाइल एक्सप्लेनिंग व्हाट इज पूर्व कर्म व्हाट इज प्रधान कर्म एंड व्हाट इज पश्चात कर्म. सो दिस इज एज पर डल्हनाचार्य. सो अगेन फर्दर मूविंग इज इफ यू कंसिडर ऑल द डेफिनेशंस ऑफ आचार्य डल्हना हियर द थ्री कॉन्टेक्ट्स ही हैज गिवन वेन शुड वी कंसिडर a particular treatment as purva pradhana or paschat depending on the condition depending on whether it is the stages of the disease whether it is the progression of the disease or whether it is samshodhana karma or whether it is in prana chikitsa. He has given when we should consider each treatment in under a separate category but he has not given a way through which we can analyze and put one particular treatment under one group. So that concept or that criteria has been explained by Acharya Chakrapani Datta in his Bhanumati Tika while explaining the same shloka. That is, he says, so he again writes the same, that is, Langanadi Virekanta Purva Karma Vanasya. He explains that shloka and he agrees with that and says that it is correct with respect to the Vrana Chikitsa. And also he gives further statements telling that what are the criteria which you have to keep in mind while categorizing any particular chikitsa for you to put it under purva karma or pradhana karma or paschat karma. He says kim tu vranashota prashamaya kriyamanam langanadi pradhanakam maiva. That is, but he agrees with the previous sentence and say but in the treatment of vranashota the langanadi kramas can be considered under the pradhana karmas. Whereas in previously langanadi virekatam purva karma vranasya cha. In the treatment of vrana we have considered it under langana. Whereas in the chikitsa of vrana shotha we are considering langana chikitsa as a pradhana karma. Why is this so? He again continues and explains it, says tasya amavasthanam pradhana karma upakaram purva karma bhavati. Tasya amavasthayam pradhana karma upakarakam purva karma bhavati. That is, here in Vranashothavastha, as we are having Amavastha, in the case of Amavastha, while treating the Amavastha of the Vranashotha, Langana Karma can be considered as Purva Karma, not as Pradhana Karma. He clarifies his own doubt by saying, Tasya Amavasthayam Pradhana Karmopakarakam Purva Karma Bhavati. So he again gives few more examples of other contexts of Dalhanacharya and he says, Yatha वमनादौ स्नेहस्वेदादि दोषविलयनादि कृतया प्रधान वमनादि कर्मोपकारकं भवति. यथा वमनादौ स्नेहस्वेदादि फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ वमना वमनादि कर्मास दैट इज फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ पंचकर्मास स्नेहस्वेदादि कर्मास आमपाचना स्नेहना स्वेदना आर कंसिडर्ड एज पूर्वकर्म. because as they help in dosha vilayana adi krutaya, as they help in dosha vilayana from the shakas to the koshta and help expulsion of the vikrita doshas out of the body, as they help in this pradhana karma, that is vamanadi karmas, sneha svedadi karmas can be considered as purva karmas in samshodhana karmas. And again he gives one more example with respect to vrana, and he says vrane tu patane pradhana karmani kartavye pachanam patanopakaritaya purva karmeti yuktaha. That is vrane tu patane pradhana karmani kartavye. In the context of or with respect to the vrana chikitsa, patana karma is considered to be pradhana karma. Pachanam patanopakaritaya, that is the pachana karma, any pachana karma which helps in which does upakara or which helps or which performs patana karma more efficiently can be considered as the purva karma for vrana chikitsa or patana chikitsa. So again he gives the exact statement and says tasyopanahaihi pakvasya patanam hitamuchyate. That is tasyopanahaihi, tasya upanahaihi pakvasya patanam hitamuchyate. So only after the vrana or the vrana shota is pakva, after the pachana chikitsa with the help of upanaha, which is one among the type of svedana chikitsa, only then patana karma is hita. So hence here, depending on the condition, we can decide whether treatment can be considered under the purva karma, pradhana karma or paschat karma. So while taking all these examples and concluding it, Acharya Chakrapani says a beautiful sentence. He says evam anyadapi, similarly in all the other diseases, anyadapi pradhana karma upakarakam, pradhana karma upakarakam. So if you speak these words, pradhana karma upakarakam, the one which helps or which does upakara for efficiently performing the pradhana karma can be considered as purva karma. Evam anyadapi pradhana karma upakarakam purva karmam udaharyet. So these can be considered as purva karma. So if you look at the commentary given by Acharya Chakrapani, you can see there is only importance, main importance given to purva karma rather than pradhana karma or paschat karma. So if you logically analyze, why is this so? Since Chakrapani Datta is of, if his adhikara is from kaya chikitsa, not shastra chikitsa, he has mainly concentrated on purva karmas rather than pradhana karma, that is patanadi karmas, and he has explained purva karma in detail. So other examples he has just considered whatever Sushruta Acharya and Dalhana Acharya has commented. So regarding the purva karma, you have to consider evam manyadapi pradhana karma upakarakam purva karma, that is all those karmas which help in performing the pradhana karma more efficiently, they can be considered as purva karma. So hope you have understood this concept. Further moving on, so we have seen what is as a whole, what is purva karma, what is pradhana karma, and what is paschat karma as per Dalhana Acharya, Sushruta Acharya and Chakrapani Acharya ji. So now we'll consider each karma individually and we'll see what are the different contexts and different references where our acharyas have given the purva karma separately, pradhana karma separately, and paschat karma separately. Here in this class we will be studying purva karma in detail. Okay, coming to purva karma, in the Agroparaniya Adhyaya, again after explaining the shloka, that is trividam karma iti, purva karma, pradhana karma, paschat karma iti, the next shloka explains what are the things to be collected. So what are the things which has to be collected before the surgery, that is for the proper procedural commitment of the surgery, what are the things you have to get collected before it. So as the name itself says, agropaharaniya, agre refers to in the beginning or before the surgery. Agre upaharaniya, agropaharaniya can be, if you split it, agre upaharaniya, agre in the beginning, that is before the surgery begins, upaharana, that is yantra shastradi sambharasya. So all the yantra shastra and other equipments or the materials which is required for performing the surgery, you have to sambharasya, you have to accumulate it before the surgery. So since you are considering all these points before the surgery, they can be considered under purva karma here. So what are those सुश्रुता एक्सप्लेन्स कलेक्शन ऑफ फ्यू मटेरियल्स दैट इज यंत्र शस्त्र क्षारा अग्नि शलाका जांबौष्ट घृता मधु वसा तैल पय श्रृंगा अलाबु जलौका पिचु प्लोता सूत्र पत्र पट्ट कषाय कल्का लेप उष्णजला शीतजल व्यजनम कटाहम एंड मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंटली परिचारक हू इज स्निग्ध बलवान एंड स्थिर. सो देर आर एन नंबर ऑफ मटेरियल्स विच हैव टू बी कलेक्टेड एंड फॉर स्टूडेंट्स एस्पेक्ट इफ आई वॉन्ट टू से देर आर इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू रिमेंबर ऑल द थिंग्स बाई हार्टिंग. इफ यू लॉजिकली हैव एन ऑर्डर इन विच यू कैन रिमेंबर इट विल बी वेरी ईजी. सो आई गिव यू दैट ऑर्डर फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स सो दैट यू कैन ईजिली रिमेंबर एंड रिप्रोड्यूस इन योर एग्जाम शीट्स. सो दैट इज फर्स्ट कंसिडर ऑल दोज थिंग्स विच हैव टू टू हेडिंग्स दैट इज शलाका एंड जांबौष्ट. शलाका एंड जांबौष्ट आर मेनली यूज फॉर अग्निकर्मा. सो यू कैन रिमेंबर दीज टू पॉइंट्स एज दे आर यूज इन अग्निकर्म चिकित्सा शलाका एंड जांबौष्ट. अगेन व्यजनम एंड कटाह अगेन दे आर टू इन नंबर. इफ यू राइट इट सेपरेटली यू कैन ईजिली रिमेंबर व्यजना कटाह दैट इज व्यजना इज नथिंग बट अ फैन मेड ऑफ बैम्बू वंशादि रचितम. Vamsha is nothing but the bamboo stem from which the fan, manually handled fan which is prepared is called as Vajanam and Kataham, Lohadi Rachitam as per Dalanacharya. That is, Kataha is nothing but any metal containers which is kept in the preoperative room for any further procedure which might be required during the procedure. These are Vajana and Kataha. So, two things you have to remember, Shalaka Jambhoshta, Vajanam and Kataham. So again, next coming to the list which has three things, that is Shrunga, Alabu and Jalauka. So why are these used? Shrunga, Jalauka and Alabu, they are used for Raktamokshana. So you can remember the third group as those materials which are used for Raktamokshana procedure. Next coming to four. So two, we have finished two groups, three one group and four one group. That is Yantra, Shastra, Kshara and Agni. So there are four items in this group. So two item group, one having two items and again four items, Yantra, Shastra, Kshara and Agni. So next we'll go for a group having five materials. That is Madhu, Gruta, Vasa, Taila and Paya. All the liquid items. So Madhu, Gruta, Vasa, Taila and Paya, Shira. So all these liquid items can be considered under one group having five materials. Again, there's one more, Kashaya, Kalka, Lepa, Ushnajala and Sheetajala. If you consider Kashaya, Kalpa, Lepa, Ushnajala, Sheetajala, all those materials which are required for bandaging. So they can be considered under one group. And last one, Pichu, Plota, Sutra, Patra and Patta. So after Kashaya, Kalka, Lepa, Ushnajala, Sheetajala, that is cleaning, you are using Pichu, Plota, Sutra, Patra and Patta for complete dressing of the wound. So these three groups you can easily remember. And last one, Paricharaka, which is very important. You have to remember in mind, the Paricharaka should be Snigdha, that is affectionate towards the patient. You should have a good will to help the patient in the procedure. Balavan, he should be strength, he should be having strength to hold the patient very firmly and tightly before during the procedure. He should not shake and cause damage to his own body, other body parts. And Sthira, he should be very stable mentally and physically. So Paricharaka, who is Snigdha, Balavan and Sthira, should be gathered before the procedure begins. So these things, if you remember, you can easily remember all the Agra Upaharaniyas, which is explained by Acharya Sushruta and which have to be collected before the surgery. So you will not miss any point if you remember in this way. So I'll repeat the order once again. The first, Shalaka Jambhoshta, Vyajanam and Kataham, Shrunga, Jalauka and Alabu for Raktamokshana, Yantra, Shastra, Kshara, Agni, 4. And next, three groups having five materials each. Madhu, Gruta, Vasa, Paya and Taila, Pichu, Plota, Sutra, Patra and Patta, Kashaya, Kalka, Lepa, Ushnajala and Sheetajala. And at last, Paricharaka, who is Snigdha, Balavan and Sthira. So hope you have understood this and try to remember in the same order so that it is easy for you to recollect and write it in your exams. So once we have collected all the required materials which is required for the surgery. What is the next step? So Acharya Sushruta in 17th chapter, he says, that is in sloka number 11 and 12, he says, Prak Shastra Karmana Cheshtam. Prak Shastra Karmana Cheshtam, that is, before the Shastra Karma, Bojaye Daturam Bishak. The Atura should be given Bojana. And he says, Madhyapam Payen Madhyam Tikshnam Va Vedan, Tikshnam Yo Vedana Asaha. If the person is Madhyapa, if the patient is Madhyapa, he can be given Tikshna Madhya so that he can tolerate the procedural pain which is occurred to him during the procedure. Or Madhya can also be given to those people who are Vedana Asaha, who cannot tolerate pain. So in those two conditions, only if they are Madhyapa, they can be advised Tikshna Madhya. That is, example, Varuni and etc. And Na Murchayat Anna Samyogan Unmattaha Shastram Na Budhyate. That is, if you give him the ahara and if you give madhya to tolerate pain during the procedure, the patient, the atura, will not go into murcha. Na murcha tyanna samyoghat unmattaha shastram na budhyate. So if you give these two things, that is ahara and madhya, to the patient, there will not be any murcha during the procedure, and hence tasmavadasyam boktavyam rogeshu ukteshu karmani tasmat avashyam. So wherever required. It's not compulsory that in every patient Varuni should be given, in every patient Tikshna Madhya should be given, or in every patient Bhojana should be given. Tasmat avashyam, wherever it is required, wherever it is necessary, only then Bhojana should be given to the patient, and Shastra Karma is done later on. The word avashyam is very important here, and you have to remember it. Coming to the next point. So now we have seen a reference of patient where references where patient has to be given ahara or madhya. In other conditions, we have seen the word avashyam, wherever required only. It is not compulsory for all the operations or in all the preoperative purvakarma procedures. So wherever it should not be given, wherever it is not avashya, for the same thing, again in Sushruta Sutrasthana 5th chapter in Agropahaniya Adhyaya itself, Acharya Sushruta gives the shloka as Muda Garbha Udara Arsho Ashmari Bagandara Mukarogeshu Abuktavataha. Muda Garbha Udara Arsho Ashmari Bagandara Mukarogeshu Abuktavataha Karma Kurmita. That is, in these six diseases, that is Muda Garbha Udara Arsha Ashmari Bagandara and in Mukarogas. So the person should be taken to operative procedures without giving any food or madhya, that is abuktavataha. It should not be given any ahara before the procedure. So why is that so? Acharya Dalhana in his commentary explains that what is the need of avoiding food in these diseases specifically. So he says, Mudagarbhadishu shat. In Mudagarbhadishu shat, that is in the above mentioned six diseases, that is Mudagarbhadi diseases, Annapurna Koshtatvad Yantra Dhanadi Bihi. So if yantra usage is done in the Annapurna Koshta, the person who has consumed ahara, if Yantradi Karma is done, Kashtam Maranam Va Prapnyoti Aturam. So that is, the procedure might become Kashta, that is impossible to perform the procedure which is supposed to be performed, or in severe cases the patient might go into Marana, he might die also. So it is better to avoid ahara in these Mudagarbhadishu shat. In Mudagarbhadishu six diseases, you should avoid giving ahara to the patient. And next he also says, Anilascha Prakopam Miti. So also by giving ahara to Mudagarbhadishu roga patients, in those six patients there is Vata Prakopa in the body during the surgery, during the Pradhana Karma. So it is better to avoid ahara. And again, next concept is Mukarogeshu Aharo. In case of Mukaroga, if ahara is given, Mukarogeshu Aharo Anguliyadi Pidanena, why performing operation Pradhana Karma or Shastra Karma in the Mukarogas, which is located in the Mukha, if the person has consumed food, that is Anguliyadi Pidanena, while performing the operation, if Pedana occurs to the region of the mukha, that is the region of the pharynx or the posterior part of the oral cavity. Grinaya cha nishkashitaha karmagatam karoti. The person might end up in vomiting and it might lead to karmaghata, which is the procedure which is being done can get hampered. So it is better to avoid ahara in mukaroga also. So again, the same concept has been explained in modern terminologies also. The gag reflex which you get while touching the posterior aspect of the pharynx. can be considered as the same example for which ahara is excluded or prohibited in mukaroga shastrakarma. So these are the concept explained by Acharya Dalhana in his commentary for the shloka number 5/16, that is in the fifth chapter Agropani Adhyaya, 16th shloka. So coming next, what is the references of Vedana Harana, or in modern terminologies if we say anesthesia? The most frequently asked question in all the karmas and all the classes, that is there any reference of anesthesia in Shastra Karma in any classics? So if you see, there are no direct references which can be compared to the anesthesia part as in modern terminologies or in contemporary science, whereas there are few references like which is given to subside the pain. That is one example we have already seen previously, that is Tikshna Madhya or Varani Madhya can be given as an anesthesia to control the pain. The pain stimulus, sensory pain stimuli, can be controlled symptomatically or temporarily using Varani Madhya. Whereas as a reference of general anesthesia or spinal anesthesia, there are no direct references. Whereas in case of Bhoja Prabandha, written by Acharya Bhoja, if you see, there is mentioning of Moha Churna, which he has explained for administration before the performing any surgery for Kapala and Shira. That is, in case of any surgeries for the head and the cranium, Moha Churna should be administered before the procedure and then the procedure should be performed. This is as per Bhoja Prabandha, that is written by Bhoja Acharya. Again, there is no detailed description of the same Bhoja Prabandha and Moha Churna. So it is still under query whether it is related to any complete anesthesia medicine or just a local application or anything. This is not yet cleared, since there is no complete available information on this Moha Churna. So these are the concept of Purvakarma as per our Acharyas, as per our classics. This is the concept of Purvakarma as explained in our Ayurvedic classics. If we consider the modern contemporary science, the allopathic science, what are the things that we have to consider while taking Purvakarma or the preoperative procedures into consideration? As we are studying Shalya Tantra, just like Purvakarma, we also have to concentrate on the preoperative procedures of the contemporary science. So we'll deal both in detail now. So we'll see what are the procedures, what is the principle of preoperative procedures as per allopathic or contemporary science. This preoperative period, as per the modern terminologies, begins from the time of the admission of the patient till the surgery begins. This period, from the point of admission of the patient in the hospital or in the surgical unit till the surgery starts, so this span of period can be considered as preoperative period or preoperative duration. So what are the things that we have to do in this preoperative period, we'll see now. So usually the patient is advised to get admitted 1 or 2 days before the surgery for preoperative assessment, preoperative investigations, etc. This 1 or 2 days is very important. Usually it should be very limited. Maximum 2 days of preoperative stay is encouraged. It should not be more than 2 days, because if the preoperative stay in the hospital before the surgery, if it is more than 2 days, there are every chances of patient getting affected by nosocomial infection, that is hospital acquired infections. So it is better to limit the preoperative hospital stay for the patient for maximum 1 or 2 days. वन और टू डेज वुड बी सफिशियंट टू कैरी आउट ऑल द प्रोसीजर्स, सो लिमिट इट फॉर ओनली 1 or 2 days. एंड देन वंस द पेशेंट इज एडमिटेड हिज कंप्लीट हिस्ट्री हैज़ टू बी टेकन विच इंक्लूड्स ऑल हिज डेमोग्राफिक डेटा, ऑल हिज क्लिनिकल फीचर्स, मेडिसिनल हिस्ट्री, फैमिली हिस्ट्री, सर्जिकल हिस्ट्री और एनी कॉम्प्लिकेशन ड्यूरिंग द सर्जरी, एवरीथिंग हैज़ टू बी नोटेड इन अ प्रिस्क्राइब परफॉर्मर एज पर द हॉस्पिटल और एज पर द सर्जिकल सेंटर एंड इट हैज़ टू बी डॉक्यूमेंटेड. एंड दैट्स वन मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक, द पेशेंट हैज़ टू बी थरोली एक्सप्लेन्ड रिगार्डिंग द प्रोसीजर वॉट विल बी कैरिंग आउट ऑन हिम एंड इट शुड बी एक्सप्लेन्ड इन दिस इट शुड बी एक्सप्लेन्ड इन दिस ओन वर्ड्स एंड इन्फॉर्म्ड कंसेंट साइन शुड बी वेल एडवांस इट शुड बी टेकन. वंस अगेन द कंसेंट इज टेकन ए थरो क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन शुड बी डन. दिस क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन शुड बी कंप्लीटली अ जनरल एग्जामिनेशन शुड ऑल्सो बी डन विच इंक्लूड्स ऑल द सिस्टम्स इररेस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द सिस्टम फॉर विच ही हैज बीन एडमिटेड फॉर द सर्जरी. सो अलॉन्ग विद दैट ही ऑल्सो द पेशेंट शुड ऑल्सो बी एग्जामिन्ड फॉर ऑल द ऑर्गन्स इररेस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द मेन कंडीशन फॉर विच ही हैज बीन एडमिटेड और प्लान्ड फॉर सर्जरी. सो वाइल डूइंग दिस एंड ऑन एडमिशन ऑल द क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशंस विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू द डायग्नोसिस विच इज ऑलरेडी मेड हैज टू बी रीपरफॉर्म एंड रीकन्फर्म टू कन्फर्म द डायग्नोसिस बिफोर द सर्जरी. सो दिस इज द एग्जामिनेशन पार्ट बिफोर द सर्जरी बिगिन्स. सो वंस दिस इज डन द पेशेंट शुड बी एडवाइज टू टेक बाथ जस्ट वन डे बिफोर द सर्जरी. शुड बी एडवाइज टू टेक बाथ एंड शुड बी the regarding the patient's admission should be informed to the respective surgeon and anesthetist should also be informed and all the reports and all the case history, any specific medicinal history, surgical history, if it is there, it has to be informed for the anesthetist so that he prepares to give what type of anesthesia to the patient depending on the history of or any complication that the patient might have experienced previously during his earlier surgeries. Based on all those history, he can decide the present operation strategy. So again, the physician has to be informed for taking physician fitness, and after that, the anesthetist has to carry out pre-anesthetic assessment. Again, this is one of the major assessment criteria which has to be done by the anesthetist. Here, he sees mainly the Malampati classification or the Malampati scoring, where he relates the position of the tongue to the pharyngeal arches. So depending on this relative position of the tongue and the pharyngeal arches, there are 4 classifications based on which we can decide whether the intubation for inducing general anesthesia, whether it will be easy, whether it is moderately difficult, whether it is difficult or whether it is totally impossible. So depending on this classification, that is Malampati classification, the anesthetist will decide what type of anesthesia or what type of patient procedure should be adopted during the surgery. So after this, again the patient should be prescribed any medicines prescribed by the surgeon or the anesthetist which has to be taken before the surgery. For example, any anxiolytics. Usually when the patients are posted for surgery, usually they have a stress and anxiety. So if there is more anxiety for the patient, anxiolytics can be given to relieve the patient. And again, if there are few medicines which have to be withheld as per the direction of the surgeon or the anesthetist, few medicines have to be stopped before the surgery. For example, aspirin, the commonest one which we know, aspirin or warfarin, it has to be stopped before the surgery if required or prescribed by the surgeon and the anesthetist. So once doing all these, so the patient, based on the history, based on the examinations and based on the hematological and pathological investigations that we carry out in the preoperative period, we can consider the patient either in good risk patient or a bad risk patient. Good risk patient is one who does not have any foreseen complications or who does not have susceptibility for any complications during the surgery. Whereas bad risk patients are those who have every chance of getting a complication during, that is in the operative period or in the post-operative period. So it might be any one of these, the patient has to be categorized. So once the patient has been categorized either as a good risk patient or a bad risk patient, so depending on the group, a following pre-operative procedure should be carried out. That we'll be seeing next. And what is the main advantage of this classification of good risk patient and bad risk patient? If you see that, so in all the good risk patients and in the bad risk patients, if the surgeon or the anesthetist see any foreseen complications that might arise, he can be well prepared to handle those complications that might arise during the procedure or post procedure, or he can also take necessary steps or measures so in prior, before the operation begins itself, so that he can avoid those complications that might arise intraoperatively or postoperatively. So this is the main advantage of classifying the patient either as a good risk patient or bad risk patient. This you have to always remember. So further moving on, so what are the exact steps that we have to take in case of good? We'll see what are the steps that we have to take in good risk patients, then we'll move on to the bad risk patients. So in good risk patients, as there are no much complications which we are expecting, so normal protocol of the surgery, the preoperative protocols can be followed. That is, main point is diet, the food. So till when the food has to be given, what type of food has to be given, and when the food has to be stopped, and the patient has to be kept nil per orally, that is NPO or nil per mouth, NPM. So till 8 hours, the patient can take a liquid food or any light food, and in the previous night also you can take any liquid food or light food which is easily digestible and which does not create any acid reflux or gastritis. So the patient has to take those kind of food. So in the next day, so the patient has to stop. If the operative procedure is planned for today, 8 hours before, the patient have to stop all food materials, the regular food materials which have a fatty content, which have lipid content in it. So it has to be stopped 8 hours before the surgery. And if a light meal or the light diet which is devoid of any lipid materials, any lipid particles, it has to be stopped before 6 hours before the surgery. Or if a patient is taking milk, and if it is a non-human milk, it has to be stopped 6 hours before the surgery. And if the patient, if a patient is pediatric, that's a baby is being operated, the breastfeeding can be continued till 4 hours before the surgery. And 4 hours before the surgery, the breastfeeding should be stopped. And all clear fluids, including water, should be stopped 3 hours before the surgery. So this you have to remember, and this is mainly followed for all the procedures, all the surgeries, if the patient is having good risk. That is, if he does not have any other expected complications that might arise. That is, regular meal including fatty diet should be stopped 8 hours before, and meal which is a light meal which is not having any lipid particles or fatty materials, it can be stopped 6 hours before the surgery. Non-human milk for 6 hours before the surgery, breast milk 4 hours, and clear fluids 3 hours before the surgery. So this timings and the type of food should be remembered. And the previous night, if the surgery is posted for the next day, the previous night, if the patient is having too much of stress or anxiety regarding the surgery, it should be well counseled, and if required, he can be given a mild sedative or anxiolytics which will give him sufficient sleep so that he can relax and be prepared for the surgery in the next day. And again, on the day of surgery, if the patient is having regular bowel, if he is not having constipation, and if his bowel is regular as usual, he can be given soap water enema in the morning of the operation. So after that, he should not be given any food, so the bowel remains empty, so that operation can be carried out without any complication. And if the patient is having irregular bowels, or if he is constipated, laxatives should be given, or pegleg enema can be given, so 36 hours before the surgery. And after that, in the morning of the surgery, on morning of the day of the surgery, again soap water enema can be given again to clear the bowels properly. So this is the bowel preparation aspect of preoperative procedure. And again, the oral hygiene should also be maintained, and the main complication of the oral hygiene is pyorrhea. That is, if the oral hygiene is not maintained properly, that might lead to post-operative parotitis and lung infections. So, as there may be entry of microorganisms into the upper respiratory tract and then into the lower respiratory tract, so there are every chances of infections of the lung in the post-operative period. So, it is better to maintain oral hygiene and advise the patient to do gargling repeatedly before the surgery, as is in NPM. Even though he's in NPM and NPO, he should be doing gargling repeatedly using just warm water or warm water along with salt. So this is regarding oral hygiene. And once the operative area is seen, once it is shaved and divide off any hair, all the septic points is nothing but any susceptible area of the operating area. For example, in the abdomen, if you consider, the umbilicus is one main septic area. Even though there are no open wound which might be present in the umbilicus region, since there is less hygiene maintained by most of the patients in the umbilicus region, it acts as one septic spot where infection can spread from the umbilicus, the external part of the umbilicus, to the operated site and cause other complication. So it is better to always maintain the area, and it should be devoid of any septic points. So if there are any septic points which are present, again it should be thoroughly washed with betadine, hydrogen peroxide, and it should be cleaned repeatedly till the septic point is cleared. So this is regarding the maintaining of the area of the operation. And again, regarding the skin preparation, it is also important to keep the area sterile till once you wash the area and keep it ready for the operation. It has to be maintained sterile till the surgery begins. So that is very important. And again, for preparing the skin, usually the razor blades are avoided, as it might create abrasions and cause a septic point which can lead to further infection. So hair removal creams can be used or trimmers can be used to remove the hair. And again, if the area is very dirty, having mud, for example, in the foot, in the creases, if there are particles of the mud, the area should be washed with turpentine or hydrogen peroxide repeatedly, and it should be cleaned properly. And if the surgery is for bone and joint operations, on bone and any joint, it should be repeatedly washed, and the shaving should be done 36 hours, and after that, repeatedly every 6 hours, the area should be cleaned with hydrogen peroxide, betadine, and turpentine if required. So once the area is shaved and it is clean, it should be washed thoroughly with warm water, and again painted, and again the area should be made clean, and again antiseptic solution or powder should be applied over the operating part, and it should be covered using a sterile towel, and it should be opened only after entering into the operating room over the table. Till then, the patient is advised not to open or touch the sterile part repeatedly. So this is regarding the preparation of the skin and the area of the operation and preparing it for the procedure. So all these procedures, what we have discussed so far, is for the good risk patients. For those who don't have any complications, don't have any susceptibility to have any complications during the surgery. Whereas if you consider those with bad risk, that is patients with any systemic abnormalities, systemic diseases, for example, obesity, hypertension, IHDs, ischemic heart diseases, so for them, what are the measures to be taken? If it is possible and your surgery is elective, and if it can be postponed, it is a best measure to postpone the surgery. And if it is not possible, the patient has to be strictly monitored based on these protocols, and these protocols should be carried out so that complications that might arise during the procedure and post-operative procedures can be avoided. So what are those? If the person is obese, so it is a main complication that happens for the obese is due to reduced immunity. As diabetic patients, their immunity is slightly reduced and sometimes immunocompromised in few patients whose sugar controls are not under control and whose HbA1c is very high. So in those conditions, usually they have high chances of infection. So for those conditions, their sugar level should be brought to normal. Sir, for obesity, the infection levels are higher as they have flabby muscles, as they have excess fat content in their abdomen or in the part of the operation, and that usually obese patient will have diabetic as an associated comorbidity. So obesity and diabetes can be taken together and have to be managed. Since again both can be immunocompromised, they have to be properly treated, and if the sugar levels and HbA1c levels are more, so proper insulin should be given based on the sliding scale, and it should be brought into normal level before the operation begins. And if the patient is having any respiratory or cardiac diseases, it should be treated well before the surgery by an expert physician, and it should be settled before the surgery begins. Because if there are, if the patient is having any respiratory or cardiac diseases, and if we give anesthetic agents which might cause bronchoconstrictions, again the patient might be having a cardiac arrest or having respiratory attack or respiratory arrest during the procedure, which might be difficult to handle and which might arise very severe complications. So it is better to treat these well in hand, so that complications can be avoided. And coming to the malnutrition and hyponatremia, so what are the problems which malnutrition and hyponatremia causes? Is mainly with respect to the healing. So malnutrition again and hypoproteinemia will cause there are less amino acids in the body, which will cause reduced healing time. The healing time will take a longer period, so that there is more chances of infection and more chances of wound complications leading to sepsis and other further complications. So it is better to correct this malnutrition and hypoproteinemia and give him sufficient protein supplements. And once his protein reserve is up to the normal level, then he can be taken for surgery. And in the same way, anemic, if the patient is having low HB, it should be corrected well in advance, either by oral medications or intravenous medications, and also along with folic acid supplements, and it should be corrected. And again, one more important topic is vitamin deficiency, which has to be corrected. The main vitamins which has to be seen and to be monitored is vitamin C, vitamin B and vitamin K. Whereas vitamin C, which is mostly helpful in the collagen formation, which helps in healing of the wound, which help in collagen formation, and which helps in conversion of type 1 collagen to type 3 collagen, which will form a firm scar to hold the two operated sites and to hold the suture in position. If this collagen formation is not taking place properly with the deficiency of vitamin C, there might be every chances of wound dehiscence. So the wound might get dehiscence. So hence vitamin C should be corrected. Again, vitamin B, mainly involved in carbohydrate metabolism, it has to be corrected for having proper energy being supplied to the tissues around for proper union of the wound edges. And again, vitamin K, as we all know, it helps in prothrombin production in the liver. So whenever there is vitamin K deficiency, it has to be supplemented by external vitamin K injections, so that the level gets equal and post-operative healing takes place early. And again, as I previously said, along with obesity and diabetes, they can be considered together, and there can be diabetes can be considered as one of the comorbidity of obesity. So in case of diabetic patients who have uncontrolled diabetes, whose sugar levels are very high, and if they have a presence of ketone bodies in the urine, if they have a presence of sugar in the urine, it should be contraindicated from the surgery if it is not an elective surgery. And if it is emergency, if it is very emergency, and if the patient has to be operated, it should be under sliding scale insulin during the procedure also. It should be given and the patient can be operated. And before doing this, the patient should be made to increase his glycogen reserve in the liver by giving glucose and insulin together by intravenously. This glycogen reserve is very important, because as in the post-operative period also, we will be giving the person, the patient, insulin, and we will be keeping the patient nil per orally. So, and this glycogen reserve helps in post operative period to balance the sugar levels in the body and helps the patient not being hypoglycemic. So hence glycogen reserve should be increased in the body by giving sugar, by giving glucose and insulin intravenously before the surgery. Once it is increased in the post operative period, it balances and helps the patient to avoid hypoglycemic shock. So this is regarding the diabetic aspect of preoperative procedures. But again, in the same way, electrolyte balance should also be seen, and electrolyte level should also be seen, that is sodium, potassium and chloride. So the level should be properly seen, because this again will have a major impact in the post-operative period during the healing period of the wound. If there are hyponatremic or hypokalemic, it might cause weakness, drowsiness, profound apathy of the muscles, weakness of the muscles will be caused. So before the procedure, during the preoperative investigations that we carry out, even electrolyte profile should be done, and all the electrolyte balance should be seen properly. And if they are not in normal level, supplement should be given, and they should be made normal before the surgery begins, before the operation is started. So these are the main thing what we have to consider in the preoperative aspects of the modern contemporary science, the allopathic surgical science. And along with the Ayurveda, we have studied the contemporary science also today. So if any doubts, you can please comment in the comment box. I'll be happy to answer that. And hope you have understood the Purva Karma aspect of the Ayurvedic classics, which have been explained by our acharyas, and also the modern concept of preoperative procedures, which is explained by the modern science. So in the next class, so we'll be taking up the Pradhana Karma and Paschat Karma, and we'll deal both the Ayurvedic aspects and modern aspects in detail. So hope this class was beneficial. Do comment the doubts. I'll be happy to answer. And thank you.